And he, his family is destroyed, and he picks up his baby sister and runs 20 miles with her to escape the aliens. See, he's not a nerd anymore, it's all your faces. You're going like, oh, I like him now. And that's when he became Yoda. I needed to create a new race of Jedi, a whole new council. I had some help with that from Doug and Tarl, but most of them I got to do. And of course, to invent characters instantly, well, you just look around you. You are all you Jedis. So I did that in the art department and put horns and wings on them, and here they are. So Eth Koth, I think his name was actually Doug Chang, the head of our department. I don't know why, but a lot of people think that's a woman. It's not. Doug Chang. And in the corner in episode 3, we heard there were going to be a whole bunch of young little... Everybody seen episode 3? Yeah. I'm sorry. Anyway, there were going to be a whole bunch of... No, come on, I loved it. I loved working on it. Come on, it's like being a parent. You know, you're allowed to say things like that. I was there to help give birth to Padme, and I was there to... bury her, right? You know. Yeah, so you know, you get very fond of them and you're allowed to say snarky things. But anyway, we heard there were going to be a whole bunch of little young Jedis. And I thought, well, what can you do if you're a little young Jedi? You'll get pulverized. So I had them work together in teams. And there's one using the Force to elevate the other one, who then lops your head off. And I think that's as far as we'll go with that. Let's choose another number.
53.
What was that?
53.
53?
Right.
Okay, 53. And then we'll jump to another booklet here. 53. Bingo! How? Well, you're into some of the new artwork for the book. So let's do this. Last of the Star Wars spreads. In fact, I'll give you the Tatooine. No! Can't see space.com. Right. Later, after you go to the theater, Jones takes him down into the catacombs down below. And there's actually, it's just this giant underground place that's been under construction for about 6 years, and it's actually my website. People keep asking. I've got the Guinness Book of Records for the longest running coming soon page. But anyway, so down there, and there's lots of scaffolding, and things are being built, right? All the different web pages are being built, and there's this giant vault door. And the interviewer, who has agoraphobia, you all know what that is, right? Acrophobia. Well, what's the one where you're afraid of heights? Agoraphobia, right. But it's also, as well as being afraid of heights, it's also being afraid you're going to jump off of something tall, which is my problem. Every time I get near something tall, my palms start to sweat. I start to climb. It's true. Now, this is not related to that, but I was in Portugal back in 1980. I just proposed to my wife. We were going to get married. Went up to the little village where she was brought up to celebrate. We're walking along this tiny little cliff ledge. It's about 500-foot cliffs, and there's a ledge 50 feet down from the top. I'm walking along the ledge. She's walking in front of me, and suddenly, the first vision I've ever had in my life, first and only, but true, like it was split screen. And in one side, I saw her walk forward, put one foot on the ledge, about 5 feet in front of us. The ledge crumbled, she fell, and she died. Oh. That was horrible.
Yeah.
And the other, she was still walking towards that spot. So of course I went, stop! You cannot walk there! And then after I convinced her not to go, this weird compulsion came over me. And I started to walk. And I took 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 paces. And the ledge crumbled, and it gave way. And the next thing I know, I'm flying backwards into space like this. And of course, being quick-witted, she reaches out to grab me, and I reach back, and we clasp hands, and in that momentary look that has lasted us the rest of our long 26-year marriage, we knew I was heavier, and I'd pull her off, and we'd let go. And I fell backwards into space. And I swear this is true, folks, I swear, I fell backwards into space, and I heard a voice, a very quiet voice, but so powerful it shook every cell in my body. And it just said, you won't die. And I thought, okay. I put my arms out. And I flew all the way down. And it was the most magnificent feeling. I would almost recommend you try it. It was every flying dream you've ever had, and it just was fantastic. And as I'm nearing the bottom, I'm thinking, I should probably grab something or I'm going to die. So I reached out to grab a tree, bang! Hit my hand so hard I had bruises right to the end of my fingertips.
Wow.
I thought, bad idea. Then I'm looking down, I see this rock on the ground. But there's a patch of sand next to it, and I start giggling because I'm tilting down head first.
Oh, Jesus.
And what do I hit? The rock! Bang! Now, has anybody ever thrown an egg off the top of a roof? And you know, if you get it just right, it doesn't break. Okay, bang, up I go, bang, land on my back. And I get up, and I'm fine.
Wow.
I have no broken bones. I have a small crack in my skull, very small, little blood running down. And I'm winded, so I can't get any words out. Well, meanwhile, Leonor's cousin's down there, having watched her fiancé fall. And then get up, and then fall down again, and then get up. She rushes over and says, "Hospital is coming." I want to explain, hospitals are buildings. They don't come anywhere you go. All I say is... So anyway, ever since then, I actually haven't had agoraphobia anymore. But I used to. I used to be really just terribly paranoid to go on bridges because I wanted to jump off. So anyway, the interviewer has the same agoraphobia, and he's walking on all this little scaffolding, and he's holding on tight to the edge just to make sure he doesn't jump off. And then he goes inside, and there's this very mournful, mournful man who keeps all of the art that I've ever done that never will see the light of day inside in the drawers. And they all rush out and try and talk to him. And so, really, this chapter is just a presentation of all the different things that stand up and do their party pieces and get to show them who they are, and then they get stuck back in the drawer again. And these were from Star Wars and will never be seen. These were shady senators swapping illegal CDs. Evil. This is the Medusa character that I tried so hard for three films to get George to do. Because Star Wars is mythology, right? It's not really science fiction, it's not really fantasy. It's all about those great archetypes with little floating droids beside them. So it looks like science fiction. So I wanted to have a Medusa character in there forever, and George would not do it, unfortunately. He gave us Tatooine. He said, "I want all kinds of rich street life by the side." So here's Tatooine gamblers, jugglers. Actually, no. See, that's the human pyramid. That's the alien contortionist and the alien who could juggle cats. Why? Because I could. All right. Oh, there we go. Yes. Okay. So then after. He's done in the vault. He goes out. They start walking away. Jones is leading them on to the next thing. When all of a sudden you hear this horrible hissing and flapping sound, something that Lovecraft would have just wet his pants to hear. And all of a sudden Jones goes, "Oh shit!" Runs as fast as he can for the elevator, totally abandoning the interviewer who's clinging onto the rail and going, "What? What?" And Jones says, "Deadlines." He reaches the elevator, looks back, and sees the interviewer standing there all by himself. He heroically runs back and grabs his cigar and gets the hell out of there, leaving the interviewer at the mercy of the deadlines. These are the deadlines from the vault, these big bat-winged, one-eyed creatures. They come flying down to destroy the interviewer, when all of a sudden, out of nowhere, whack! Big pieces of masonry fly in and squash them to pieces as the interviewer flies off the edge and starts to fall down, 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 down. The last thing he sees is this heroic monster with giant pieces of masonry smunching deadlines before he hits total blackness and conks out. And that's the end of that chapter. Right, let us escape from this particular spread. How y'all doing?
Great.
All right. Awesome. Shadowline part two. Oh, and by the way, I always leave some part of me behind when I come to do a talk. This time it was my watch. What time is it? It's 12:12. Yikes, 12:12? How long do I have?
As long as you need.
As long as you need. They never eat again. So tell try that. Okay, let's choose two or three from this and one from the last. Quick, number?
22.
20. But you know what? That's not...